Welcome back. Today we are going to discuss the topic of chemical bonding. So what is chemical bonding? Chemical bonds are forces that attract or hold the molecules together. How many types are there? We're going to discuss three main types of chemical bonds. First, the ionic, then the covalent, and then the hydrogen bond. Let's look at how these are going to be different and how they are going to work in the body. What happens in an ionic bond? There is transfer of electrons. So one atom will donate its electron and the other atom is going to receive this electron. As a result, we're going to have two ions. The one that gained the electron is called the anion and is going to be negatively charged because you remember electrons are negatively charged. The one that loses the electron is called the cation and it is positively charged. This helps you to remember the N in gained, negative anion. This is a very famous example of ionic bonds. This is a sodium atom and a chloride atom. Sodium is going to donate one electron to chloride and they will bind and form sodium chloride. Now sodium has a positive charge, it is a cation, and chloride has a negative charge because of the electron and it is called an anion. So this is chemistry. How does this actually work in our body? It's very important to remember that something like sodium chloride can dissolve in water because the ionic bond is a relatively weak bond. And when this dissolves, it's going to form a solution, and this solution has the ability of conducting an electrical current. So something like sodium chloride is called an electrolyte, sodium, potassium, and so forth. How do these work in the body? It's the electrical conduction that occurs in both the nerves and the muscle tissue. It is due to those electrolytes. And this is something that most of us are familiar with. This is a recording of the heartbeat. This is an electrocardiogram. This is the machine where the recording occurs. What do we see? Those waves show the movement of the electrolytes in a certain sequence in the heart muscle. This is an electroencephalograph. And this also shows the waves, and the waves are a conduction of the nerve impulses that occur in the brain, and it is due to the movement of the electrolytes, sodium, and so forth in a certain sequence. So we can use those bonds and those electrolytes in certain important functions in the body. Our second bond is the covalent. Look at the word co. They're going to cooperate. They're going to share. So covalent bonds are made by sharing of the electrons. But there are two types of covalent bond. If the sharing is equal, we call this nonpolar covalent bond. So the shared electrons will spend equal time between the two atoms. This is the strongest of all the chemical bonds we're going to discuss together. In the polar covalent, there is unequal sharing, so the shared electrons will orbit a little bit more around one of the atoms more than the other. This is the nonpolar, so there's equal sharing. Let's look here. This is hydrogen and hydrogen. They are going to bind by a nonpolar covalent bond, which means they are going to share an electron each. So each one of them is going to share an electron, and this makes H2. Remember, this is one pair of electrons shared between both of them. So the electrons are going to spend equal time with both of them. This is a nonpolar bond. If there is only one pair of electrons, we call this a single nonpolar covalent bond. This is another example for oxygen atoms to form an oxygen molecule. Again, the oxygen atoms are going to share electrons. In this case, they are sharing two pairs of electrons between them. This is the symbol for the double bond. So we call this a double. It's still nonpolar, which means that the electrons will spend equal time orbiting between those two atoms. We can also have a three or a triple nonpolar covalent. The example is nitrogen, where the shared electrons are three pairs and they will spend equal time between the two atoms. In the polar covalent bond, there is sharing, but there is unequal sharing. And this is a very good example here. The bond within one water molecule, it occurs between an atom of oxygen and two hydrogens. So there is sharing of the electrons between them, but what will happen is, because there are more neutrons in the nucleus of the oxygen, the electrons are going to orbit for a longer time around the oxygen and spend less time around the hydrogen. So this side of the molecule is going to be slightly electronegative. This side of the molecule is going to be slightly electropositive. We call these partial charges, and this is why we call them polar. It's like there's a negative pole on this side of the molecule, and there's a positive pole on that side of the molecule. The third bond is the hydrogen bond. What happens in the hydrogen bond? There's an attraction between the partial charges of different atoms. We're going to look at this in a minute. This is the weakest of all bonds, but it is highly important. We're going to see it's important in the water molecule. We're going to see how it is extremely important for the structure and function of proteins and the DNA structure. So this is hydrogen bonding. This is a molecule of water, another and another. How do these bind together? These are all hydrogen bonds, hydrogen bonds, hydrogen bonds, and they make a body of water. And this is very important for cohesiveness. This allows the water to make a film, an uninterrupted film in many areas of our body. So we have a film of tears that covers the surface of our eyes. How does it form and stay intact? It's because water molecules hold together and stay tight. This is another extremely important example of hydrogen bonding. This is a molecule of DNA. It is made up of two strands, and these strands coil around each other, and they are bonded by weak hydrogen bonds here in the middle. This is extremely important because every time the cell divides, we have to make another copy of DNA. So the hydrogen bonds will easily break. Each of the strands of DNA will make a complementary copy and then unite again. So this is extremely important for the function of DNA. We should have a bond that will easily separate and reunite. In protein molecules, the hydrogen bonding allows the protein to take a shape. So proteins are long strands of amino acids. They can be like a long thread, but eventually they can take three-dimensional shapes. They can make a pleat, and finally they can make a very important three-dimensional shape for a very specific function like this. So how does this occur? It's through the hydrogen bonding between the different parts of the amino acids. In conclusion, let's look at a quick comparison between the three types of bonds. In ionic bond, remember there is transfer of electrons. So I will have two charged ions. One is a cation and anion. And our example here was sodium chloride. In the nonpolar covalent, there is equal sharing of electrons. I don't have any charges, and we can have a single, double, or triple covalent bonds. In polar covalent, there is unequal sharing. There's going to be a partial charge on my molecule, and this is the water molecule. Slightly electronegative charge on one pole and slightly electropositive on the other side. The hydrogen bond, and remember again, this is our weakest. There is attraction between the partial charges. This is going to give the molecule its three-dimensional shape, as we have seen with the proteins. And again, thank you again for joining us. And this concludes our talk on chemical bonds.